فألقوا إليهم القول إنكم لكاذبون وألقوا إلى الله يومئذ السلم وضل عنهم ما كانوا يفترون الذين كفروا وصدوا عن سبيل الله زدناهم عذابا فوق العذاب بما كانوا يفسدون ويوم نبعث في كل أمة شهيدا عليهم من أنفسهم وجئنا بك شهيدا على هؤلاء ونزلنا عليك الكتاب تبيانا لكل شيء وهدى ورحمة وبشرى للمسلمين.
الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن حمده.
الله أكبر.
الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله starting tomorrow عصر إقامة will be 6:45 and عشاء إقامة will be 10:30 بإذن الله تعالى. And also the حلقة with شيخنا الشيخ عبد الله will be taking place after سنة بإذن الله تعالى.
طيب السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. نشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. طيب إن شاء الله we'll continue on our parables of the Quran. We are on, let me see what page we are on. The long book that we are going to go through. So we are on page that is 607. طبعا these are, the whole book started from page 1. So this is the third volume. Today we are going to deal with the issue he has here. It's titled قارئ القرآن العامل به والمعرض عنه. Like the one who recites the Quran and act accordingly or upon the Quran. The person who doesn't, or the person who knows the Quran but does not act on him. The surah that is the focus of this chapter is Surah Yunus. Yunus is chapter 10 in the Quran. It starts with talking about the Quran. Alif Lam Ra, tilka ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it. Like many of the surah of the Quran, the focus of the surah is the Quran, the book of Allah itself. One verse I always mention it is verse 25 on it, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. Indeed, Allah guides people to the way that takes them to دار السلام. دار السلام is Jannah. That's paradise. ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. And to go to paradise, you have to go through الصراط المستقيم. And this صراط المستقيم is following رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because Allah سبحانه وتعالى said in Surah الشورى about the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Indeed, O Muhammad, you are the one who is going to guide people to the straight path, which is going to take them to paradise, which is Dar al-Salam. This is the basically the focus of Surah Yunus. Now, he starts this by saying, this hadith of Imam Bukhari. It's a very famous hadith reported by Imam Bukhari, where the Sahabi who reported, I said this many times that, we can hardly remember all the Sahabas, but these are mentioned in the book, so you, in case you can retain it. And there is a Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his name is Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. Abu Musa used to be more concerned, diamond ask questions about the Quran. You see, a lot of the hadith, he was asking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to teach him about the Quran. So he starts by saying, عن أبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, the Prophet said, المؤمن الذي يقرأ القرآن ويعمل به كالأترجة طعمه طيب وريحها طيب. Said a believer who recites the Quran, who reads the Quran and act according to the Quran, like he does what the Quran says for him, he described him by a fruit, and the fruit is called الأترجة. الأترجة is a fruit. According to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said طعمها, like it has a very good fragrance. You know, there are some fruits that if they're at the end of the house, you smell them. And at the same time, it's very sweet. So both the fragrance that comes from it and the taste of this fruit is so this is the mu'min, a believer, as Rasulullah said, who reads the Quran. And he acts according to the Quran. And he sticks to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. That's the first one. He said, وَالْمُؤْمِنَ الَّذِي لَا يَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ وَيَعْمَلُ بِهِ كَالتَّمْرَةِ. The Prophet said, there are believers who don't recite the Quran, and they don't read it, they don't go and khum, so on, but they act according to what the Quran says. The Prophet described this person as a date. You know, dates, they don't have a smell, but they are sweet. So the date is don't have a smell, but it's very sweet. Now the third, he said, كَالتَّمْرَ طَعْمُهَا طَيِّبْ وَلَا رِيحَ لَهَا. Like the taste of a date is very good, but it doesn't have a smell. I can have a bag of dates here. You don't smell just like this at Rujja. ومثل المنافق الذي يقرأ القرآن كالريحانة. And a believer who is منافق. He says, ومثل المنافق الذي يقرأ القرآن. He's منافق, but still he reads the Quran. And this is the person that the Prophet warned us from. He said, the worst person, he said, منافق عليم اللسان. Like a منافق, a hypocrite, but his tongue is so sweet. And this is many of them now, yeah. All what we see that they speak very well, they don't, but they are hypocrites, they don't. He said this one is Karayhana. I don't know if you're familiar with the Rayhan or not. A Rayhan is a tree. It smells very good, but it's sour in taste. And Rayhan, if you put the Rayhan there, you'll smell it here. Even when you, like if you squeeze it with your hands, all day you can smell the fragrance of a Rayhan. So this is a person who is a munafiq because he has the Quran. That means he has the smell, but he is very bitter. Like inside, he's not. Then the last one, he said, طعمه. ومثل المنافق الذي لا يقرأ القرآن كالحنظلة. And a munafiq who does not read the Quran is the worst one. He describes him by الحنظل. الحنظل, actually, people who live in deserts, we have it in Sudan, very every place. الحنظل is small size like of a watermelon, very small, this much. But it is so bad, so sour, that even if you put your finger in it, for days you smell bad things in your hand. And all of this is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah created all of it. So he said that a person who is a munafiq and he does not read the Quran is like, قَالَ طَعْمُهَا كَالْحَنْظَلَ مُرْ أَوْ خَبِيثٌ وَلَا رِيحَ لَهَا. Like the smell is bad, the thing is bad, so everything is bad. هذا لفظ الحديث في البخاري. And this is where the Prophet, again, we told you about the parables. This is a series that we are talking about أمثال القرآن. Just now, by the way, the Sheikh read one of the أمثال. And this is سورة النحل. I don't know if you pay attention to the recitation or not. He says the two people, one of them is like a person who is good, who spends money and so on. You cannot compare him with a person كلٌ على مولاه. Like he's a what we call a liability on the person is أينما يوجهه لا يأتي بخير. Wherever they tell him, it does not come as good. So he had made this parable between the two. And these are the parables that we said in the Quran. So this hadith is a parable of the Quran. Now we have the four categories. A person who reads the Quran, acts upon it, is like an atrujja. And actually the atrujja itself is not only that it has a good smell and a good taste, but it's very easy to eat. Like, you know, there are some fruits. I don't know whether you call it. إيش القسطة بيسموها في مصر. I think in Egypt it's common. There is a fruit, like a cup. I don't know what it is. See, the fruit from outside is green, but inside is like ice cream. Even people eat it with a spoon. You have it, I don't know the English name for it. What is it called? It's common in Pakistan. In a sweet apple? Or you call it sweet apple? نعم. We have it back home. So it from outside is green. When you cut it and then you open it, actually it's just like a cream, it's white. People eat it with a spoon. This is called قسطة في مشكلة. قسطة عند في مصر. We know it by قسطة, you don't know the other name. I never thought about the English name. So it's called the sweet apple, sorry, or sugar apple. Oh, mashallah. You know it, so you're familiar with it. Yeah. It actually is green from outside. But when you cut it, it's white, very white, just like ice cream. And then people use the spoon to eat it, basically. Tarifa? MashaAllah. Good, so now you know. In Egypt, it's called Qishta. In Sudan, they call it Qishta. In the next, it's empty. But Sharifa, sweet apple, sugar apple, custard apple. So you know what I'm talking about. Good, that's what we learn from each other now. Alhamdulillah, I got all these now names for it. So Al-Atrujja is something similar to that, but it's not the same as the sweet apple that you said. So Al-Atruj, it has a fragrance. By the way, there are sin. This is where the difference between what people call, you know, here they use it as organic, right? It's fruits that go to any store now, go to any supermarket. You see all these apples and so on and so on, just like pictures. They don't have any fragrance. Back home, I remember it. I just came from the Sudan, you know, a few months ago. If there is banana in that room, you smell it here. When you come on, everything smells because everything is like that. So the Prophet والسلام, compares the person who acts, reads the Quran, acts upon it, kal atrujja, this beautiful fruit. Now, so there are four categories. The second category is a person who reads the Quran but does not act upon him, right? So the Prophet the person who doesn't read the Quran but act on the Quran, he said, is like a tamra. Tamra is what? Don't have fragrance, but it's very sweet. الريحان is the worst, that this is the منافق who read the Quran. Like from outside, he smells very good. From inside, طبعا the نفاق is basically the contradiction between person's act and what he says and how does. The worst is this handle. And handle, as I said to you, this is the worst type of it. It's small. Actually, it's like, what do you call them? Like trees that are grow on the ground. And they don't have stem or anything, just like that. And then you see, just like watermelon. And people actually take it also for watermelon. Remember when we were little kids, we used to get it thinking that watermelon, the minute you open it, for days you have to wash your hand. It's really bitter. And then it's bad. So this is how the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام described these four categories. وهذا لفظ الحديث البخاري فيه بيان فضيلة القرآن يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى maybe we said to سورة يونس and we are going to go through so many verses now from سورة يونس because it all revolves around the Quran. He says هذه الأمثال هي النبوية like this is the prophetic parables. We have the Quranic parables that we deal when we get from the Quran and these are the prophetic of them. He says وجاء في صحيح البخاري هذا في فضائل القرآن. You know, in Bukhari has a chapter called Fadail al-Quran, Tirmizi has Fadail al-Quran, they said so. They narrated all these hadiths. Part of this, he talks about the origin of the word. And this, I don't want to trouble you with it. This is for people who are learners. يعني مثلا, he says, يعني how the word is mentioned, where it is mentioned. He says, جاء في كتاب الشعراء والبلغاء لمقاسم حسين الراغب الأصفهاني, مش عارف مشارع. Yeah, this is, I told you many things of these books are, and even if we say them, they will come from here and go from here. So you don't have to waste time on them. This for people are researchers. They want to know where the word is. Then, as I said to you, people are the Arab writer, all of them are fond of poetry. Everything they make a poem for it. He says, وَأَتْرُجَّةُ مُدَّةْ أَصَابِعَ مِنْ ذَهَبْ لَهَا أَرْجُ مِنْ فَأْرِتِ الْمِسْكُ مُنْتَهَبْ بَدَتْ لَهَا وَالْرِّيحُ بْمَاجَ مِنْ ظَلَامِ فِي الْكَابِ الْغِنَارِ إِنْحَزَّهُ الْرِّيحُ بِالشُّعَبْ. This is how they make it poetic. Or this one. So it's, again, okay. It's not for you. He says, ويشير ذلك إلى طيب رائحة الأترج وهي من الأرج الذي يفوح. يعني the word أرج means something that spreads around. يعني it's not just contained on it. He says أيضا هل العراق للناس خالد قال يطلقون لفظ الأترج على نوع من فصيلة البرتقال. They said in Iraq there are certain types of oranges, not just normal, because they smell very good. Normally it doesn't. And they're very sweet. He says, وهي من فصيلة في البرتقال معروف أيضا في مصر. Like people in Egypt and so on. وهي عطرة وطعمها حل. And there's some oranges like that. So they compare them with this atraj that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام mentioned in this. He says, this is all poetry. You don't have to go on it. He says, والأترج الرائحة الطيبة والجميلة هي المقصودة في الحديث. يعني the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام wants to describe a person who reads the Quran, who takes care of the Quran, and at the same time act accordingly. So this is the person that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام described. And he says وهو القارئ للقرآن, the person who reads it, العامل بأحكامه, the person who actually committed to the commands of the Quran, المتأدب بآداب القرآن, the person who holds the manners, whether it is the ظاهر or باطن, like in appearance or inside. This is a person who is heart and mind and words and tongue, all of them are in line of good with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, وهذا الذي يسور يسير في وفي نور القرآن معه. يعني he says this is the kind of person that you can see that the Quran actually gives him this light and nur for him. وهو ما هذا الصنف الذي ذكره الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم هو قلب المؤمن الطاهر like a person whose heart is pure, he's clean, he doesn't hold anything, grudges or envy, all these diseases that we know of the heart, we mentioned many of them along this. هذا هو الصنف الأول. This is the first one. قال والصنف الثاني في الحديث النبوي هو الذي يقرأ القرآن ولكنه معرض عنه. يعني he read the Quran but he didn't act according to it. And then طبعا الله went on to see even the last person that we have. وقال الريحان كله طيب الرائحة. This one is called ريحان from رائحة. رائحة means smell or fragrance. So the word itself comes from there. He says ولكن طعمه خبيث. يعني you can hardly, if you take a small piece of this ريحان, it's very bitter. It's small, it's not common. I don't know what you call it in Pakistan. It grows. Normally people put it in the houses because it gives the basil. Oh, good. You know what a basil is? I don't. Good to live. It's called basil. But it's a green, very fragrant. يعني, you see it, but it's very bitter. You can hardly taste it. He says, ولذلك هو المنافق. أما المنافق هو الذي ظاهره طيب. يعني fragrance, but باطنه خبيث. Like internally, it is not. ومذاقه مر. Like this is what the taste of it is really bad. أما الصنف الرابع واللي هو أشد في الذم وأقبح في العمل وهو المنافق. يعني he doesn't read the Quran, he doesn't act on it, and then he mentioned this حنظر. قال والحنظر ثمر النبات الصحراوي من طعم خبيث وريح خبيث. Like it's bad both in its taste. قال بعض الشراح إن كلام الله له تأثير في باطن العبد وظاهره. يعني طبعا the Quran basically has an influence or effect on our appearance or what you do and also internally on what we say, what we utter and so on. He says, فانظر إلى دقة هذه التشبيهات. And see how the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام has described these four categories of people. والمقصود منها, he says, هي أقسام العباد. These are the people that actually vary in their salah, in their piety, in their goodness and their mercy and in the thing that they have this purification of their tongues and so on. He said, كان عبد الرحمن السلمي إذا ختم الخاتم القرآن أجلسه. This is Salami, one of the companions of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, when somebody completes the Quran, like you know, during Ramadan we have khatim, people lie in and make the dua. He said, كان إذا ختم القرآن أجلسه بين يديه. He said, he'll put him between his hands. And then he put his hand on his head. And then he said to him, يا هذا اتق الله. فما أعرف أحدا خيرا منك إذا عملت بما عملت. Is to keep him like somebody finishes the Quran of his students, bring him, put his hand on his head, and he said to him, fear Allah, be mindful of Allah. I don't know anyone who is better than you for what you did if you act accordingly. And you finish the Quran, but you act according to the Quran. وقال قتاتة لم يجالس أحد هذا القرآن إلا قام بزيادة أو بنقصان. And this is the verse that we are going to say from Surah Yunus. This is from Surah Isra. He says there isn't anyone who sit down to read the Quran. It's one of the two things. Either he gets an increase in reward or a decrease that Allah promises. And then he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. نُنَزِّل, we send down from this Quran what is shifa, which is healing and mercy for believers. But straight Allah says, وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. يعني a person who reads this like the منافق who reads the Quran and so on, actually repeating the Prophet in one of the other hadiths, he said, كَمْ مِنْ قَارِئٍ لِلْقُرْآنِ وَالْقُرْآنِ يَلْعَنُ. يعني there are some people who will be reciting the Quran will be cursing them. Because these are the people who are not keeping the Quran. So Allah mentioned in this verse, by the way, this is called Ayat al-Shifa. Some of the scholars use this for ruqya. They say, just keep reading this word. On a person, وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارة. وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا يزيد الظالمين خسارة. This is verse 82 by the way, Surah Al-Isra. If you want to see, go to Surah Al-Isra 82. ولا يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارة. This why he says لم يجالس أحد هذا القرآن إلا وقام بزيادة أو نقصان. يعني if you read the Quran, it's one of two things. Either you get increase in your reward or decrease because if you don't act on it. وهو القرآن ولذلك ذكره الرسول كأنه ربيع القلوب. You know in the dua the Prophet used to make and normally you make it in the khatim, he used to say اللهم اجعل القرآن ربيع قلوبنا. الربيع is the best time of the season when everything fresh and this fresh is the heart. He said وهو ربيع القلوب الذي ذكره الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام في الدعاء. اللهم اجعل القرآن ربيع قلوبنا وشفاء صدورنا. You hear this dua all the time. ونور أبصارنا. And he said also ونور البصائر. Because the Quran is the one he guides. وكما تحيي الأرض الطيبة بالقيث تعطي الثمرات كذلك تحيي القلوب بالقرآن. He said just like when water comes on earth and then it gives life to the earth so that things can grow. The same thing with the Quran. It gives life to the hearts of people. He says وتخشع وتجتهد في طلب مرضاة الله. وقال بعض العلماء إن هذا القرآن أتانا من قبل ربنا عز وجل. This Quran came directly from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. actually came directly from Allah and came directly to Jibreel. Jibreel directly sent it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, and it's come, keep in mind, whenever you read the Quran, you are reading something that came to you straight from Allah. He is, وَلِذَلِكَ تَعَهَدُوهُ وَتَدَبَّرُوهُ فِي الصَّلَوَاتِ وَقِفُوا عَلَيْهِ فِي الْخَلَوَاتِ. He said, this is why I reflect on the Quran, think about the Quran, especially in your prayers, and when you are lonely with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pay attention to it. He says, مَا زَرَعَ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plants in our hands. That's why the Prophet said, إِنَّهُ رَبِيعُ الْقَلْبِ كَمَا أَنَّهُ غَيْثُ رَبِيعَ السَّمَاءِ. وَقَدْ جَاءَ فِي الْأَثَرِ إِنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يُكُمْ مُتَّصِفًا بِأَخْلَاقِ الْقُرْآنِ فَإِذَا قَرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ نَادَاهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى مَا لَكَ وَالْكَلَامِ أَنْتُمْ عَرْضُونَ. سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ الْعَظِيمِ. He said, a person who reads the Quran, a caller will come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will say to him, what are you doing with my words? And you are turning your heart away from me. So when you read the Quran all the time, keep your heart with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وطوبى للمؤمن الذي يقرأ القرآن. طبعا this is what he said, ولنكون جميعا كالأترجة طعمها طيب وريحها طيب. This is the last word he said in this section. He said, then let us be like what Allah, the Prophet described, the person like الأترجة, this beautiful fruit that Allah said. عن أبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه, again أبو موسى said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, تعاهدوا هذا القرآن. تعاهدوا means take care of it. Be careful about it. When you read it, you are reading with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be alert to what you are reading from Allah. فَوَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ لَهُوَ أَشَدُّ تَفَلُّتًا فِي صُورِ الرِّجَالِ مِنْ الْإِبْنِ مِنْ الْأَقْلَى. By this hadith that he posts itself a lot of time going through it. He said this Quran, if you don't really take care of it, it runs away from you. By the way, this we all call volunteers trap. Sometimes we like memorize certain verses, even smaller chapters, and we forget them. And he said, all the time, keep in mind, try, this is why we keep repeating the Quran over and over and over. He said, try to keep the Quran, because it runs away as if you have a camel that runs away. And you know, he mentioned the camel, Ibil, because the camel is very violent when they run away from you. So this is what Abu Musa al-Ashir said. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, according to Sahih Bukhari, he said, إِنَّمَا مَثَلْ صَاحِبَ الْقُرْآنِ كَمَ صَاحِبَ الْإِبِلِ. He said, Allah described the person who, like taking care of the Quran, is the one who is owning these camels. He said, is in عَاهَدْ عَلَيْهَا تَمَسْكَ. And if there are some people who are very skilled in keeping their camels, no matter how many they are, no matter how wide, how difficult they are, but they are able to control them. وَإِنْ أَطْلَغَهَا ذَهَبَتْ. And if you let it go, it will let go. قالوا في بعض الروايات أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال استذكروا هذا القرآن. استذكروا means repeatedly turn out the Quran. Try to keep the verses that you know, the parts of you know, so that you don't lose them from your memory. He said, فإنه أشد تفلتا من الرجل الصمان من النعم في عقله. And عقل is the rope is which you tie a camel or you tie a camel. He says, keep track of this Quran and don't let it go. This is why in the old days, by the people used to it. Remember, I have my grandmother, rahmatullah alayha. She lived long, 100 years. When she stands in prayer, she reads everything she memorizes in the Quran. And people will come and tell her, like, why are you putting yourself through this? She says to them, are you jealous of me talking to my Allah? And when she starts to read every verse, she remembers she reads it. It doesn't matter what surah and so on. Allahu Akbar, and then she went on and on and on and on. So, هذا توجيه نبوي. He said, this is a prophetic directive from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for us, so that we try to keep the Quran, try to use it. And we know that the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam has been given the wisdom by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he actually part of the message of Rasulullah, this is wisdom. He said this many times. Remember in the early days of our tafsir, and especially the repetition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم about the hikmah. That's why some of the scholars say that al-hikmah here is sunnah. يعني Allah gave the Prophet al-hikmah. Hikmah, which he told us to do it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us part of the mission of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. As a matter of fact, he gave it more important than other things. If you recall about the mission of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, and you said this was set by Ibrahim alayhi salam. You recall back in the days when we were in Surah Al-Baqarah, we said that Ibrahim alayhi salam used to say, أنا دعوة أبي إبراهيم. The prophet used to say, أنا دعوة أبي إبراهيم. I am an answer to a prayer. Recall that my father Ibrahim made. يعني الله sent رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم as an answer to a prayer that Ibrahim made. Now let's go to the Quran and see where Ibrahim made that dua. Remember when the prophet Ibrahim عليه السلام, Allah commanded him to rebuild the Kaaba. Right? He showed him the place of the Kaaba. And actually the Kaaba is not built by Ibrahim. It was rebuilt by him. Originally, the Kaaba was built by Adam عليه السلام. So Allah in the Quran says, وَإِذْ بَوَّأْنَا لِإِبْرَاهِيمَ مَكَانَ الْبَيْتِ, that we showed Ibrahim where the house is. And then we commanded him to rebuild it. Right? وَإِذْ بَوَّأْنَا لِإِبْرَاهِيمَ مَكَانَ الْبَيْتِ, so that becomes like the main focus of our ibadah, our direction and so on. Then he said, when Ibrahim and Ismail were raising the buildings of the Kaaba, they were building it, they made this prayer. And it's in Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah said, وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلِ, when Ibrahim and Ismail were raising the pillars of the Kaaba, they made this prayer. They said, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. The first thing they said to Allah, oh Allah, accept from us. By the way, all what we do, all what we say, the most important part of it is to beg Allah to accept it. Because if Allah accepts it, if it doesn't like it, then accept it. So they said, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. This is the first part of the dua. Then they said, رَبَّنَا وَاجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكَ, and then makes us Muslims, and then from our progeny, make them Muslims. وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا, and then they said to Allah, this is the second part. The third part, they said, رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. Oh Allah, send them, those people in Mecca, where the Kaaba was built, send them a messenger from among themselves. I told you this was repeated in the Quran so many times. Now, so the prayer says, رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. Oh Allah, this is Ibrahim and Ismail praying. They said to Allah, send them a messenger from among themselves. And then they ask Allah for what they want this prophet for. Remember these words? They said, رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. First, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. You can relate your verses. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. Remember, number two is what? To teach them the book. And then, الْحِكْمَةِ. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Allah's them, يُزَكِّيهِمْ. See this sequence here? First, to send this prophet to recite the book or relate the book to them. Teach them the book. Then teach them wisdom. Then purify them. Now, Allah, we said this, answer this prayer. This in Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah answered this prayer in Surah Ali Imran, the third chapter, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, quote, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Indeed, Allah has given this favor. Man is mean gift from Allah. إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. He sent them a messenger from among themselves. Now, look at the sequence. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. They didn't say, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ, as came in the prayer. To show that this task is more important than even everything. The Prophet's role is this. Then يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Those four things. Now, the four is a slight change. We said the change came from teach them the book to wisdom and then reverse them. From there on, throughout the Quran, this sequence was maintained. يعني, مثلا, again in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the same thing in a form of a reminder. A reminder starts this way. كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْكُمْ, as we have sent you a messenger from among yourselves. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِنَا وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. So Allah said, remember what we did. We sent you a messenger among yourself to recite the book, to purify you, يزكيهم, then to teach them a book, and then. And then the last one, as I said to you, the same sequence is in Surah Al-Jum'ah. And I told you the significance of Surah Al-Jum'ah in relation to the importance of the role of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in Surah Al-Jum'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began the surah by saying, يُسَبِّحُ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ الْمَلِكِ الْقُدُّوسِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ. طيب, هو الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. It is he, Allah, who sent those people who are in letter, a messenger from among themselves. يتلو عليهم آياته ويعلم يزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة. So four places in the Quran with the slide saying that Allah said from the beginning. I said the significance of Surah Al-Jum'ah in particular is because, and I said it many times, no one can worship Allah with the Quran by itself. You have to go to the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As in, you will not be worshiping Allah. Why? Because in Surah Al-Jum'ah, this is the answer for me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed on us to pray Jum'ah. Like the last verse of Surah Al-Jum'ah says what? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Allah said, when the call is made on prayer, then you go for prayer. That's it. This is the only verse in the Quran, the only verse that speaks about Salat al-Jum'ah. There is no details of it. There are about 11 or 12 rules of Jum'ah. The time for Jum'ah, the rak'ahs of the Jum'ah, whether to read loud or silent, whether there is a khutbah or not, whether the khutbah is before or after, like Eid and Jum'ah, whether there is a congregation. The number, yani all these rules, none of them is mentioned in the Quran. So if a person wants to fulfill the command of Allah by praying Jum'ah, because Allah said, if the call is made, you have to, he will be lost. Where does he have to go? Back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where? Actually, this verse in Surah Al-Jum'ah, that's the importance of it. So Allah said, well, you have the Prophet. He gave you the book, but also Allah, and then he teaches you the book. So what comes from the book, that what you go for, inshallah. Clear? We mentioned this before, but I want to refresh you for it, inshallah. Right. So Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, رضي الله عنه, he said, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the people. And he says, استذكروا هذا القرآن فإنه أشد تفلتا من صدور الرجال من النعم في عقله. And he said, if you don't keep a track and keep an eye on this Quran, then you will lose it. Because it's more faster to leave you than even an animal that's not being shackled or being held by a rope and so on. He says, ولذلك فإن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ينطق بالحكمة من قلبه الشريف. Because every word that رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم is actually from heart, it comes from wisdom. وقد أوتي جواعم الكلم. Many times I said to you, the prophet words are very small, very little. This is why, by the way, many people wonder, you know, right now we have the khutbahs in Jum'ah. Some people give a khutbah an hour and a half, some people get. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, we find, we don't have a book called, يعني the only collection that's made about خطب الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام is just the simple ahadith that he said. The whole book. There's a professor from Palestine, I think he's in Chicago University, and he compiled a book. It's called خطب النبي. I have it with me in my office. And this خطب actually, because they used to say خطبنا رسول الله, like the Prophet said this. And then you get a hadith. That's all what the Prophet said. They said the most the Prophet used to do from the member is to actually praise Allah. Yani half or one, two-thirds of his khutbah was praising Allah subhanahu. And you all this, we take bits and pieces. Yani, he starts in alhamdulillah. And one of the actually things that he presented, he says, Allahumma inni ahmaduk hamdan, yani yukafi'u ni'amak, yuwafi mazidak. Like, I'll praise you as much as I can satisfy you with that. Nobody can then. And then at the end, the Prophet himself say, لا نحصي ثناء عليه هو كما أثنى على نفسه. Yeah, nobody can really praise Allah enough. And this is why the Prophet himself used to say, and we leave it for you to praise Allah. And Allah did praise himself. Remember many times I told you, all this, the word hamd, that we start. I said to you in the Quran, there are five chapters. Remember them? Five chapters, they begin by alhamdulillah. Right? يعني يستاذ سورة الفاتحة الحمد لله رب العالمين سورة الكهف الحمد لله الذي أنزل الكتاب على عبدي سورة فاطر الحمد لله فاطر السماوات والأرض you go to سورة إبراهيم الحمد لله يعني all these chapters start is الحمد لله الحمد لله الأنعام الحمد لله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض يعني Allah praised himself before anyone praised him and he praised him therefore so the Prophet used to do this and then his khutbah was a few words. Remember, I repeat this khutbah for you. I think by now you should memorize it. I said one time, like this is the first khutbah in the book. The first book in this book called Khutbah al-Nabi. This is the first khutbah. He said the Prophet went to the member, Hamad Allah bima huwa ahlul lahu wa athna alayh. Like he praised Allah. He, يعني, whatever يعني, is more fitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he said, remember the khutbah? A minute and a half. I can say it to you right now. A minute and a half. He said, أيها الناس, remember, just could you watch. This is all what the Prophet said. He said, قال أيها الناس, إن لكم معالم فانتهوا على معالمكم. وإن لكم غايات فانتهوا إلى غاياتكم. وإن العبد المؤمن بين مخافتين. بين أجل قد مضى ما يدري ما الله قاض فيه. وأجل قد بقي ما يدري ما الله فاعل به. فليتزود العبد من نفسه لنفسه, ومن حياته لموته, ومن صحته لمرضه, ومن غناه لفقره, ومن شبابه لهرمه. فوالذي نفس محمد بيده ما بعد الدنيا من دار إلا الجنة أو النار ثم جلس. How long is that? Half a minute, 2 minutes, 1 minute? That's what وصلنا, this is khutbah. Now if I want to translate this to you and tell you all the lessons in it, it will take an hour. Because every word in it. This is why according to the description here he said, قال وقد أوتي جوامع الكلم. And Aisha رضي الله عنها said, when the Prophet used to speak, you can count the words he says. Very precise. And this is even the hadith that you see on yourself all the time. There are 333. We mentioned about the thuluthiyat. Remember it? Told you there is one Syrian brother, mashallah. He compiled a whole master's thesis. It's called the thuluthiyat. Thuluthiyat means every time the Prophet says three things. Saras. He gathered about 200. All of them is 333. Right? Remember the hadith I gave you? I told you to memorize it. This one is actually Imam Ahmed in his Musnad compiled one of 12 of these. He said, Thalasun muhlikat, wa thalasun munjiyat, wa thalasun kaffarat, wa thalasun darajat. Four. Each one of them have three. He said, three destroy a Muslim. Three things. And three save a Muslim. Savior. Three purifies a Muslim. And three raises the rank of a Muslim in paradise. You have 3, 3, 3 by 4, that's 12. And each one of them is a hadith by itself. Just 3, 3, 3, 3. Right? Now, so he said, his words are very precise and to the point. And he says, البلاغة. البلاغة in Arabic, like the highest level of what we call people who speak for that one. He says, وَكَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَفْصَحَ الْعَرَبِ. And the Prophet himself, by the way, even the Arab, and you know, they were poets, they were this, they were that. وَإِذَا تَكَلَّمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ يَأْخُذُ عُقُولَهُمْ وَأَسْمَاعَهُمْ فَهُمْ حَتَّى الْكُفَّارِ. Remember the incident where one time some of the kuffar went like in secret to hear what Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم reads. And each one of them thought he's the only one who's doing that. Then they found themselves, everybody's sitting there, and they start fighting with each other. Because this is what even like the key of the kuffar used to say this about the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna alayhi la halawa, like this is very sweet, and then describe how it is and so on for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلِذَلِكَ يَقُولُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ. And from this is what Allah gave Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, قَالَ وَأَنَّ الْحَبِيبِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُحِثُّنَ عَلَى تَعَاهُدِ الْقُرْآنِ. We say تعاهد, that's what he means. He says, هو حفظه ومدارسته وفهمه وأحكامه. يعني, لذلك قال, تعاهدوا هذا القرآن. To try to memorize it, to try to understand it, try to act on it, and so on. And he says, وقد نبه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الأمة وحثهم على ذلك لأن الله سبحانه وتعالى عندما أنزل عليه القرآن. When the Prophet was receiving the Quran, Allah before he received this, he said to him, said what? This is سورة المزمل. يا المزمل قم الليلة إلا قليلا ينصه أو ينقص منه قليلا أو زد عليه ورتل القرآن ترتيلا إنا سنلقي عليك قولا ثقيلا. That's the Quran. Said to me, I'm going to send this down to you. And he says, لِأَنَّ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لَا يَسْتَضِي حَمْلُ كُلُّ فَرْضٍ. يعني a person who sort is not open to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not open it. Despite the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeated this verse so many times in Surah Al-Qamar. You know Allah repeated, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. So So Allah said, we have made it easier for people to receive it. It just needs to. And he says, يَسَّرْنَاهُ أَيْمَنَّاهُ سَهْلًا فِي الْحِفْظِ وَالْقِرَاءَ and so on. That's why النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم he says, أَنَّ حَامِلَ الْقُرْآنَ كَصَاحِبِ الْإِبِلِ. يعني he mentioned this also again, that he is because he the person who has camels, despite the fact that he said Allah chose the camel, the Prophet chose the camels to be this climb because the camels are the wildest animals, you know, a huge animal. And when a camel goes wild, really wild, nobody can control it. And this is why he said Allah took this one. And this is why قال وأن عقلها يعني to hold it, this way you tie it and so on. This is what about the Quran. وقد خص النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الإبل بالذكر that he mentioned it لأنها أشد الحيوانات الإنسية نفورا. يعني you know all these domestic animals, the worst of them is the camel. By the way, they said the camel can take a grudge and crush a person. You see this many times, I don't know, you go to YouTube. يعني somebody angers a camel can sit on him and just kill him. There is a picture one time on night, they said a donkey started bothering this camel. And then the camel just took him and crushed him. يعني he's very huge, he's very strong, and this is why he has this strength for him. He says, وَأَنَّ صَاحِبَ الْإِبِلِ أَكْثَرُ النَّاسُ حِفَاظًا عَلَيْهِ. Like a person, this is why the description came about the camels. And Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه said, إِنَّمَا مَثَلْ صَاحِبَ الْقُرْآنِ كَالْصَاحِبَ الْمُعَلَّقِ إِنْ عَاهَدْ عَلَيْهَا أَمْسَكَهَا. He said that if a person like takes care of it, then he will be able to control it. Otherwise, it will leave him. فذلك مطلوب في تعاهد القرآن والمداوم على تلاوته والاستمرار. Like he says, this is what is required about the Quran, reading it and so on. He says أيضا تأمل كيف أبرزت شبه هذا المثل بصورة محسوسة مما جاء. يعني he says Allah سبحانه وتعالى makes us to look at the picture, and this is the أمثال. Basically the parables comes in here. يعني Allah will give you something that you see it in front of you, and then you can see it, and then he says it becomes easy to remember it because you live by it, you see it and so on. And he says ومن تشبه بالمعقول, like what Allah سبحانه gives us these parables, they are things that we can see in front of us and we can relate to them. وقد أشار النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى الصنيع من يتهاون بأمر الاستذكار والتعاهد فيه وذم ذلك. ذلك في الحديث الذي أخرجه البخاري. He said this is why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said this in a hadith reported by Bukhari. He says بئس ما لأحدكم أن يقول نسيت آية كذا وكذا. Said the worst person will say, oh, I used to memorize this surah, but I forget it. I used to memorize this verse, but I forget it. He says, Malmussi, because he didn't take care of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it out of his memory. He says, استذكروا هذا القرآن فإنه أشد تفص. يعني he used another word, like تفلت, means تذكر يعني. He says, all this is actually to tell us how important for us to keep track of whatever we need to know from the Quran so that we don't lose it. He says, وتعاهد القرآن هو هذا. يعني when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet said, تعاهد means take care of it. He says, don't want it. وقال لا تقول نسيت بل نسيت. And don't say I forgot it. I was made to forget it because it should be in your memory and that's why you have to keep it. And he says, وطلب القرآن, like a person who tries to keep it, keep track of it, will be what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And then he said, وَلَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ, you know the verse, لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ. If this Quran was sent upon a mountain, the mountain will completely submit to Allah and it will shatter itself because it is of the fear of Allah that's going to happen. He says, وَهَذَا الْقُرْآنُ نُورٌ, it is a light, المحافظة عليه, it keeps that light in the heart of a person in what to do and so on. Then here you make a prayer, he said, اللهم ذكرنا ونسينا, this part of the dua, you say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, keep us, remember what you have granted us from the Quran, علمنا ما جهلنا, that you make us actually know what we don't or what we are ignorant about, وجعلنا من أهل القرآن. طيب, now Allah comes between the Quran, how much time do you have? Let's say, so we have this section, so we can finish the longer section. طيب. Now come to the parable that we said from Surah Yunus. Oh, it's long. You know what? We can start it, but if we finish it, fine. If not, we can complete it next time. طيب. The parable. قال تعالى في سورة يونس this Surah Yunus, this is verse 24. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now prepare us from the Quran, give us the parable. He said, إِنَّمَا مَثَلُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, the similitude, the parable of this worldly life, كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. The parable is, this dunya is like water that coming from the heavens. فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ. You know, when it comes to earth, you have seeds, you have this, it gets mixed with in the what we saw it. مما يأكل الناس, from what we eat, like all these things that we grow, we eat them. الناس والأنعام, يعني people and animals, most animals, cows and goats and so on, they eat from what Allah has sent from the heavens, from the rain, and what is mixed with the earth. He says, مما يأكل الناس, this is the parable. والأنعام, حتى إذا أخذت الأرض زخرفها وزينت, you know, when you have this what we call dry soils and so on, then the rain comes, it changes completely. By the way, one of the things that people noticed who just came from Umrah, if you came from Umrah, you know Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said towards the end of time, all the deserts and the mountains of Saudi Arabia will change into greenery. You were surprised now. Go to Umrah and everything that we used to see as bare desert sand, now is green. All over the place. And people took so many pictures about that. That's what the Prophet said. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the problem. كَمَثَلِ مَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ مِمَّا يَأْكُلُ النَّاسُ وَالْأَنْعَامُ حَتَّى إِذَا أَخَذَ الْأَرْضُ زُخْرُفَهَا وَزَيَّنَتْ. طبعا, you know, when you see this, even here, by the way, one time, I don't know whether they start do that or not. You know, if you drive, I did drive actually, through the, what do you call them? Edna, Saskatchewan, so what do you call it? Huh? The prairies. You know, they used to do this, I don't know whether it's still in good. They used to have like a line of castors, what do you call it? Sunflowers, you see. In the middle, they have certain kind of, and then when you drive, you see as if you are driving a carpet. They used to do it, by the way, in Toronto Island. I don't know if they stopped it or not. You have to go to Toronto Island, they have these flowers. They had one line green, one line blue, one white. There's some parks here, they do the same thing. And you can see the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in there. And same soil, different colors, different flowers, different, even the fragrance that you have. All these things that they produce, like perfumes for them. A lot of them used to be taken from flower. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called this Zukhruf. Actually, there's a chapter called Zukhruf. We'll come to it. Zukhruf means the decoration. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decorated. He said, حتى إذا أخذ الأرض زخرفها وزينها. Took all this decoration and became by that one. Then what happens to it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, not only this, وظن أهلها أنهم قادرون عليها. You know when people have full control, they think this is it. He said, أتاه أمرنا ليلا أو نهارا. Allah will cast his power on it. فجعلناها حصيدا كأن لم تغن بالأمس. Allah can wipe this completely. As if it has not been even tilted or there's something that's grown on it. So هذا المثل ضربه الله عز وجل لبيان حقيقتها. يعني this is to show exactly what dunya for it. فالدنيا تتعدد فيها المفاتن والمفارق وهي كزرع. Like this dunya has so many things, many desires, many good things and so on, and many things of it. ثم he said تجتاح الحواج. Like a rain will come, a fire will come, something will come. And to wipe all of this. وهذا المثل جاء في سياق سورة يونس بعد أن خوف الله عباده من المعاصي. يعني this similitude, this parable came in سورة يونس after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us warnings of not to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, يا أيها الناس إنما بغيكم على أنفسكم. For people, when you are, بغي means transgression, keeping away from Allah, it is from you. متاع الحياة الدنيا, just the short time that you have in this dunya. ثم إلينا مرجعكم فننبئكم بما كنتم تعملون. We all know, Allah said this, الله يبدأ الخلق. Allah initiated our creation, right? Then we die. Then he's going to re-initiate it. الله يبدأ الخلق ثم يعيده ثم إليه ترجعون. Then we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In another verse, Allah says, الله الذي خلقكم من ضعف ثم جعل من بعد ضعف قوة ثم جعل من قوة ضعفا وشيبة. يعني this sequence of life. You start with a weakness, you grow, you become mature, you become strong, and then you come down, and then you become weak again. You go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says في هذه الآية إيغاظ. This is to wake us up. And then we realize exactly what this worldly life means to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وهو تنبيه للعباد. It is a reminder for us so that we know exactly who we are in relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says this dunya, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, measured it in always. So on the description of dunya and so many things Allah gave description for it. And this is why, through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us, you know this, Allah wants to first to inhabit this earth, to develop things on it, to live a good life on it, but not to say, this is the last thing that one. So Allah said, Allah created so many good things for this dunya for us, right? قل من حرم زينة الله التي أخرج لعباده والطيبات من الرزق. That there is so many things that in this dunya, so many good things Allah gave us. So inshallah we'll stop here. This is just the beginning of this chapter, by the way. So next time we're going to maybe review it and then we can continue with it. We say سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك صلى الله على سيدنا محمد. Took some minutes from you or still time? Oh, good. Yeah, and we didn't go by past the time. Oh, now, yeah. We're going to call the Azan at 10:10. I see. Good. And by the way, from next week, it's going to be 10:30. Am I right? So we'll have more time. Five. Huh? Sorry? Change the time? I have no problem. I'm for you. So whatever you agree on, how is it? What do you want to do it? We end in Maghrib. You want to do that from next week? We can send that. By the way, people are online. This is why initially I thought I'll cancel the class because they told me there is no staff here. But alhamdulillah, they came and they said they put online. I told them I'd be here anyway. Pipe, Kade, let us see your opinions. We have two choices. One choice is to stay after Maghrib, which is going to be after 8, 9 o'clock basically, and then we can go until Isha, or start before Maghrib. The sisters too, by the way, sometimes we are very considerate of what you say. We can start early. We used to do that also. Five. You want to start when? After Asr is going to be early? Sorry? Let's hear what you say, sisters, because you need to adjust you. We can start, five. Maghrib will be what? 8:40? 9 o'clock roughly. 9 o'clock. Five. Do you want to start at 8? We finish by Maghrib? We can start at 8 and we finish by Maghrib. Damn. But then let us see who is going to go for that. Although, by the way, the people online, please let me know also. So you want to start 8, we finish by Maghrib time. Right? So you want to do that as of next week? Alright, tawakkalna Allah. So let's go and do it, inshallah.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهي عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون وأوفوا بعهد الله إذا عاهدتم ولا تنقضوا الأيمان بعد توكيدها وقد جعلتم الله عليكم كفيلا إن الله يعلم ما تفعلون ولا تكونوا كالتي نقضت غزلها من بعد قوة أنكاثا تتخذون أيمانكم دخلا بينكم أن تكون أمة هي أربى من أمه إنما يبلوكم الله به وليبينن لكم يوم القيامة ما كنتم فيه تختلفون ولو شاء الله لجعلكم أمة واحدة ولكن يضل من يشاء ويهدي من يشاء ولتسألن عما كنتم تعملون ولا تتخذوا أيمانكم دخلا بينكم فتزل قدم بعد ثبوتها وتذوقوا السوء بما صددتم عن سبيل الله ولكم عذاب عظيم ولا تشتروا بعهد الله ثمنا قليلا إنما عند الله هو خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون ما عندكم ينفد وما عند الله باق وليجزين الذين صبروا أجرهم بأحسن ما كانوا يعملون من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة ولنجزينهم أجرهم
بأحسن ما كانوا يعملون فإذا قرأت القرآن فاستعذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنه ليس له سلطان على الذين آمنوا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون إنما سلطانه على الذين يتولونه والذين هم به مشركون وإذا بدلنا آية مكان آية والله أعلم بما ينزل قالوا إنما أنت مفتر بل أكثرهم لا يعلمون قل نزله روح القدس من ربك بالحق ليثبت الذين آمنوا وهدى وبشرى للمسلمين الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين ولقد نعلم أنهم يقولون إنما يعلمه بشر لسان الذي يلحدون إليه أعجمي وهذا لسان عربي مبين إن الذين لا يؤمنون بآيات الله لا يهديهم الله ولهم عذاب أليم إنما يفتري الكذب الذين لا يؤمنون بآيات الله وأولئك هم الكاذبون من كفر بالله من بعد إيمانه إلا من أكره وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان ولكن من شرح بالكفر صدرا فعليهم غضب من الله ولهم عذاب عظيم. ذلك بأنه مستحب الحياة الدنيا على الآخرة وأن الله لا يهدي القوم الكافرين. أولئك الذين طبع الله على قلوبهم وسمعهم وأبصارهم وأولئك هم الغافلون. لا جرم أنكم في الآخرة هم الخاسرون. ثم إن ربك للذين هاجروا من بعد ما فتنوا ثم جاهدوا وصبروا إن ربك من بعدها لغفور رحيم.
الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن
الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
الله أكبر. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده.
الله أكبر.
الله أكبر.
الله